Hello everyone, I really hope you're able to see me. I'm really, really sorry. There was some technical error. We were not able to just log in, and that is why we had to log in back to our main LawSeeCo channel. So we will just start the quiz in a minute, just that. And we have already have some participants, so we will start the quiz very soon. And if you have to enter, the passcode is 86215222. So just go to www.menti.com and use the code 86215222. And I request all of those who have joined through Zoom meeting, please mute yourself. So I'll just wait for one more minute, all right? So go to www.menti.com and enter the code 86215222. So till then, let's discuss this article for a minute. The Bengal candidate lists take time. Basically, this article talks about, because as we know that the elections in Bengal, West Bengal are going on, and the election commission plays a very important role here. And that is why the questions that we will be following will come through the election commission, all right? Okay, so I think I'll start the quiz then. Okay, so we have four participants already. I'll wait for 30 more seconds and then I'll read out the question. Okay, I'll start it. We're already running out of time, and rest can join. The code still remains valid, all right? Okay, so you have to answer fast to get more points. Which of the following is a constitutional body? Your options are Election Commission, National Commission for the Scheduled Castes, Finance Commission, or all options are correct. I hope this is not causing a problem to you all. Okay. So the correct answer is all the options are correct, and only one of you has given the correct answer. See, be it the Election Commission, National Commission for Scheduled Castes or Scheduled Tribes, the Finance Commission, all of these are constitutional bodies. Now, what do we mean by constitutional bodies? That all of these have a mention in the Constitution and they exist by virtue of their a particular provision, a particular article that deals with their existence. So all of the options are correct. And thus, let's see the other question, the next question. Okay, so I'll wait after every question, since yesterday we saw some problem with the interface. So I hope now you're all on the same page as I am on. Okay, so here we have the second question. Okay. Which of the following articles of the Constitution envisages the provisions relating to the Election Commission? So your options are Article 148, Article 324, Article 233, or Article 356. It's relatively an easier question. I don't know what's happening with this. Yes, four of you have given the right answer. It's Article 324. See, Article 148 talks about the Comptroller and Auditor General of India. Right? 324 talks about the Election Commission. 233 talks about the appointment of the district judges, and 356, this definitely could not be the answer because this talks about the president role when we talk about the emergency. So 352 is national emergency, 356 is the president rule, and 360 is the financial emergency. Okay. Let's move towards the next question. So I hope you all are able to move as along with me. So this will be the third question. Which of the following is a function of the Election Commission of India? It is a relatively very easy question. Your options are conduct free and fair elections, to cancel polls in case of violence, booth capture. All right. You already have the answer. Exactly. I couldn't even read the options. That's amazing. Yes, all of the above is the right answer because all of these are the functions of Election Commission of India. Now, be it at the national level, when there are elections at the All India level, like for the parliament, Lok Sabha, or if they're at the state level. So all of these would be the functions of the Lok Sabha. Okay. So now the next article here talks about High Court declines plea against working of NCLT, NCLAT. Now, these are two bodies which have recently been a lot into news. So these are also important bodies that look into some particular kinds of cases. Now, if I would tell what kinds of cases, then definitely you'll be able to answer the next answer, next question. And I think I'll get going. Otherwise, you'll read out the correct option as well. All right. Just a second. Give me a second, please. Yeah. So here is your question. And you have to answer fast so that you can score more. The NCLAT has been constituted to hear complaints against the orders of NCLT under Section 410 of the Companies Act 2013. The term NCLAT stands for National Company Lawyer Action Tribunal, National Collective Law Action Tribunal, National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, or National Company Law Appellate Nation Company Law Appellate Tribunal. So the options are a bit close, so be very careful as to what are you answering into it. Okay, we already have. Right. I think we really have all, you know, well-prepared and buckled up people all in the quiz today. So yes, National Company Law Appellate Tribunal is the full form of NCLAT. And if we talk about the NCLT, it is just National Company Law Tribunal. So the NCLAT looks after all the appeals that come from the NCLT. And in fact, NCLAT is also responsible for looking into appeals from various other, like we have the bankruptcy, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. So there are a lot of bodies whose appeals go ultimately to the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. Okay. So our next article talks about alert helps foil plan to hack power systems in Telangana. Now, as we know that cyber attacks, cyber hacking, they have become a big, big problem these days. So this article also talks about one of these cyber attacks. Like there are lots of kinds of cyber attacks. Like we have phishing, we have malware, etc. So this talks about one of the malwares based on which we have our next question. So, all right. We already have the leaderboard first. Let's see. Okay. So like yesterday, I guess it is Jyoti Singh, the one who had also participated yesterday. So Jyoti has scored the highest till now. But since we have a lot of questions coming up, you can buckle up. Manish, we have on the second position. Jasmine on the third. Boti Mech Boatface. All right, that's a fancy name. He or she, the person, is on fourth position. And we have Navdisha, who is on fifth position. Good luck, guys. Buckle up. We still have a lot of questions to go. So now let's see that. Now this question will be based upon the malware, which we just discussed. Okay. Which of the following is a malware? Now, please see the options carefully. Your options are Dodge or Dog. Some people call it that way. Shadowpad, Ethereum, or Bitcoin. We already have the answers. Exactly. Yes, Shadowpad is the right answer. It is a kind of malware. Basically, what a malware is, it is a kind of software which is mal in nature, like which malproduces or which malfunctions, causes any kinds of malfunctions in your computer system. And thus, malfunctioning plus software has become what we call as the malware. Now, if we talk about the Dodge or Dog, Ethereum and Bitcoin, These are all the kinds of cryptocurrencies. So Bitcoin, for sure, that is why nobody has marked it. I'm really sure why you didn't mark it. But if we talk about Doge and Ethereum as well, so these are all three of these are kinds of cryptocurrencies, while Shadowpad is a kind of malware. All right. So our next article talks about DU to issue digital degrees to 2017 to 19 graduate soon. Now, when we talk about the digital degrees, and it is closely associated with the Digital India program, this Digital India mission that we have. And thus, there is the next thing that we'll discuss in this next question, which is very important, which is a very important part of the Digital India campaign. So that actually will make it possible for the Delhi University to issue the digital degrees to its graduates in the coming time. So thus, let's see what is the question. Okay, your question is, which platform helps to issue and verify documents online, thus eliminating need to carry physical documents? It's a very easy question. I'm sure you can crack it. Digital Bank, DigiLocker, DigiLedger, or Digital Doc? Of course, I can't even read the options that quick. I mean, it is. India mission, because this is a kind of like, for example, when we go to the banks, we keep our important stuff like jewelry, etc. We keep it in the locker of the bank. So we believe that they are completely safe over there. Just that way, DigiLocker is kind of an online portal that is like a locker for all our documents. So all they can be easily verified also over there, and they can be easily stored in the DigiLocker as well. All right. Now, the next article talks about the Himalayan Cerro spotted in Assam. Now, on this note, though we do not have a question today in this regard, but one point I would like to tell you, that Himalayan Cerro is a species which is very rarely spotted. Recently, like before in Assam, it was spotted in the Spiti Valley of Himachal Pradesh. And thus, you should remember that Himalayan Cerro is basically, it is kind of an antelope. So this is actually a mixed breed of various kinds of animals, like it has dog, cow, pig, etc. So it is a crossbreed of various kinds of animals, and thus it is an antelope, which is very rarely spotted. So, but after that fact, let's move towards our next question, which is related to this particular article. All right. So your question is, which of the following protected areas is not located in Assam? Please pay attention, is not located in Assam. Your options are Kaziranga National Park, Dibru-Saikhowa National Park, Manas Tiger Reserve, or Dichigam National Park. If you have any hold over the current affairs, you'll definitely be able to answer this question, because all of these were in news as well. All right. Right. So yes, Dichigam National Park is not located in Assam. See, Kaziranga National Park is one of the most famous national parks of India as well, and specifically if we talk about Assam as well, because the one-horned rhino is it is the home for the one-horned rhino. So Kaziranga National Park definitely could not have been the answer. If we talk about the Dibru-Saikhowa National Park, then this was particularly in news, I guess, a few months ago, because there was a gas leak which had occurred in a well over there, and thus there was a lot of damage that occurred to Dibru-Saikhowa National Park and its species as well. And even Manas Tiger Reserve is an important tiger reserve of Assam. But Dachigam National Park does not fall in Assam. All right. Now our next, because yesterday also we took questions on the Iran nuclear deal, but since it is very important and really has the potential to be asked in exam, so today also we have an article called as Reviving the Iran Deal. So let's read out our next question. Okay, the Iran nuclear deal is in news. With respect to it, what does the term JCPOA stand for? Just yesterday we had discussed. Be quick. Your options are Joint Collective Plan of Action, Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, Joint Collective Points of Action, or Joint Comprehensive Points of Action. Okay, all right, yes, definitely. Okay, so we have the right answer. It is the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, not Joint Collective Plan of Action. Those who have joined right now, please, I request that please mute your mic and do not share any videos while the session is going on. See, the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action is a nuclear deal. All right, I think I would not be getting into details, because our other questions are associated with it. We'll discuss it further in the end of this list of this question. Okay. So I think, yes. So we have a next question, question 9. All right. Which country had withdrawn from the Iran nuclear deal in 2018? So your options are Germany, USA, China, or UK. Which country had withdrawn? Okay. All right. So everybody definitely knew the answer. Yes, it was USA. And why is it in news? Because it was Donald Trump, who was the previous president of the United States of America, that he actually had withdrawn from the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or what we commonly know as the Iran nuclear deal, in the year 2018. So basically what happened was that he was not at all willing to get into this or remain into this deal. But why this entire thing is into news? Because now the new president, Joe Biden, has actually said that he would be making efforts in this direction to rejoin the Iran nuclear deal back. Okay. So let's have the 10th question. After this, we will have the leaderboard. So buckle up and try to answer the correct one as well as the quickest one. So the Iran nuclear deal between Iran and P5+1 was signed in which year? Your options are, I think told you the answer, 2014, 15, 16, or 13. I just told you the answer. So just remember what I told you. In which year was it signed? Come on. Oh, already we have the answers. Yes. So I'm sure that three of these are very keen listeners, because yes, the answer is 2015. So it was, I just mentioned that it was signed in the year 2015. Not 14 or 13. It was signed in 2015, and in 2018, US had withdrawn from the deal. Okay, so now I think we'll have the leaderboard. Let's see who is leading. Okay. All right. So I think the scores have remained like the tally is same. We have Jyoti on the top right now. We have Manish. Then we have Boti McBoatface. could have this name been longer. Anyway, Jasmine and Navdisha. But I can see the points are quite close. So there is still very good chance. See the top scorers and all of these. All right. Okay. Let's go for 11th question. I think it'll be again regarding this very deal as well. Okay, so which of the following countries had withdrawn from the Iran nuclear deal in the year 2018? Of course, oh my God. Come on, it should not even take more than 5 seconds. Which country had withdrawn? Oh, all right, yes, of course. See, we were just talking about USA withdrawing itself from the JCPOA or the Iran nuclear deal in 2018. So the answer is USA, not China. All right, so it is still there, and USA, all right, the answer would be USA. I think that would be really enough. Okay, let's see what is the next question. I hope all of you are not facing any problem with the interface. That's why I'm just going a bit slowly today. Okay, the term P5+1 is in news recently. Who are the members of P5? Now, P5, what P5 is, I'll tell you after this. I hope with the options you'll be able to see. So just see, read out for them for yourself. Otherwise, you'll get confused. US, UK, Russia. All right. Exactly. So this is the right answer. The P5 members are the 5 permanent members of the United Nations Security Council. So Japan here, see, US, Russia, China, France, all of these are, but Japan is not. So it is UK, not Japan. So US, UK, Russia, France, and China, they are the permanent members, 5 permanent members of the United Nations Security Council. Now, as we know that there are total 15 members of the UNSC, of which 5 are the permanent members and 10 are the members that keep changing after, it's a period of time. And as we know that recently India also has been given the position of non-permanent member of the UNSC. So these will be the 5 permanent members. And also India has been recently demanding that, not even only in India, other countries also have been demanding that they should be given permanent position in the Security Council. Even Japan also has been favoring this decision. Okay, let's discuss the next question. So the Bush administration once in the US designated Iran to be a part of axis of evil. So it included Iran and which other countries? So axis of evil, Bush administration had talked that these countries are the axis of evil. So your options are India and North Korea, Iraq and North, Of course, we have the right answer. So it is Iraq and North Korea. So that was a comparatively tough question. I'm really happy that you guys were able to answer this. See, it was not Iraq and Syria. See, North Korea is one country that US is completely anti about. As we know that Iran, North Korea, now these are the countries that the US has not been really liking, the Russia as well. So here it was Iraq, North Korea, and other these countries that had been termed as the axis of evil. That is that which means that all the problems in the global order are coming from these countries. That was the contention which was given by Bush administration. So yes, the correct answer would be Iraq and North Korea. And see, definitely India could not be an option because India has good ties with US. And obviously, Egypt has nothing to do with all this matter. So the answer would be this one. Okay. Now, the next article about which we'll be discussing in the sense of questions is the survey as policy with ideological overtones. So basically, it talks about the inequality which is existing in the socioeconomic aspects in the country. Now, here is a very interesting question for you all. Because this particularly is not a current affairs based question, rather it is a vocabulary based question. So buckle up. Vocabulary based question this is. So the meaning of the word inegalitarian, it's easy, is closest to which of the following? Equality, inequality, being kind or support to the democracy. Inegalitarian, okay. Oh, we have the answers. Of course, this had to be the right answer. So it is inequality. So when we talk about aspiring or looking forward to an egalitarian society, so by that we mean society that propounds and that focuses upon equal behavior or equality. And thus, on the contrary, the antonym is inegalitarian society or anything being inegalitarian, which actually professes inequality amongst people, status, caste, culture, etc., anything. Okay. Okay. So it'll be the 15th question. After that, we will again have the leaderboard. So be very quick and try to answer the correct option. Who prepares the economic survey? It's a very interesting question. Who prepares, okay? The Department of Economic Affairs in Finance Ministry, Department of Home Affairs in the Home Ministry, Department of Economic Affairs in the Defense Ministry, or none of the options are correct. I think the options are comparatively easier. So I think you'll be able to crack it, of course. Yes, it is the Department of Economic Affairs in the Finance Ministry. See, the ministries, that are there are various kinds of ministries, like we have ministries for Jal Shakti, Family Welfare, Health, etc. So every ministry has various departments. So these departments take different functions and thus they have to work or walk in the same direction. So if we talk about the economic survey, it is prepared by the Department of Economic Affairs in the Finance Ministry. And what economic survey is? See, how economic survey is different from budget. Every, like in every financial year, the economic survey, two documents are presented before the parliament. First is the economic survey and then we have the budget. So economic survey, as the name itself is telling, it is a survey of the economic condition or the economic status of the country in the previous year. So for example, if economic survey was presented in the year 2021, February, last month itself, so it was a complete survey of the performance of the India as an economy in the previous year, that was 2020. And if we talk about the budget, which also is a very important document, but budget talks about the coming plans for the coming financial year, okay? So these are the two important things that we need to keep in mind. So we'll have the leaderboard, let's see. Oh, okay, okay, I think we might have after this question. My bad. Okay. Who presents the economic survey? Now we know who prepares the economic survey, but who presents the economic survey? Union Home Minister, Union Finance Minister, Union Defense Minister, or none of the options are correct. Now, for those who have listened to the previous discussion, you'll definitely be able to answer. Yes, it is the Union Finance Minister, because recently, as we had seen, that our Union Finance Minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, she had presented the economic survey as well as the budget also in, and she put it in front of the parliament for the discussion. So yes, it is the Union Finance Minister. Okay. So the next article that we'll be discussing about is the anatomy of spring ceasefire. Now, these ceasefire and India-Pakistan relations are very important. Okay. So let's see what is the next question that we will be discussing. It's a comparatively long question. Read carefully. Who is the current Pakistan Army chief who was in the news recently for signing the India-Pakistan ceasefire agreement in February 2021? Basically, your question is, who is the current Pakistan Army chief? Options are Asif Nawaz Janjua, Raheel Sharif, Kamar Javed Bajwa, or Imran Khan. It was a bit into news. Definitely, I'm sure you must have heard the name. But I think it's a tough question because, okay, we already have the votes. Yes. So it was Kamar Javed Bajwa. He was a lot into news because he is the one who has signed this agreement for India-Pakistan ceasefire. Basically, what ceasefire agreements are, that the army personnel or the forces that are deployed on the border, they will be ceasing to fire, which means they would not fire on the opponent army or army personnel. So this is basically very important to maintain the security and peace at the borders, which the international borders that the countries share. So thus, recently, India and Pakistan have signed this agreement to adhere to ceasefire in February 2021. And thus, it was the Pakistan Army Chief, Kamar Javed Bajwa, who actually was in news due to this issue. Okay. So we have the leaderboard now. Okay. So we still have Jyoti who is leading. All right, we have a change here. So Navdisha has moved to the fourth position and Jasmine, it's totally fine. She has moved to the fifth position and others have remained the same. So see, it's really good. Navdisha, congratulations. And we really hope that in the next questions also, all of you can do really well. Okay, so the next question would be, the Indian Chief of Army Staff. Now, just we talked about the Pakistan Chief of Army Army Staff, and now we have the Indian Chief of Army Staff who announced the India-Pakistan ceasefire agreement signed in February. So, who is the Army Chief of Army Staff in India? General J.N. Chaudhary, General Bipin Rawat, General Manoj Mukund Naravane, General Dalbir Singh Suhag. Yes, the right answer is General Manoj Mukund Naravane. So as we know that in the Indian forces, we have the army, we have the air force, and then we have the navy. So all of these have their different chiefs, and basically by staff, we mean the entire force. So the chief of army staff is General Manoj Mukund Naravane. Okay. So the next question also, let's discuss, I guess it's related to the same topic. The first war between independent India and Pakistan ended with which year war termination ceasefire agreement signed under UN representatives? So what was the name of that particular agreement? Karachi Agreement 1949, Tashkent Agreement, Shimla Agreement, or the Sachetgarh Agreement? So the correct answer is Karachi Agreement. No, it was not the Tashkent Agreement. Tashkent Agreement was a different one. But if we talk about this one, it is right after the independence of both the countries, it's 1949, that the independent India and Pakistan ended their war by terminating the ceasefire agreement, and this signed, which was signed under the UN representatives. So it was basically the Karachi Agreement 1949. Okay, with this, let's see the next question. So there are only three questions left. So please be quick and the scores can still change. So be fast, okay? The line of control was delineated by which agreement? The line of control. Tashkent Agreement, the Sachetgarh Agreement, Karachi Agreement, or none of the above? Now maybe, you know, you have the answer. So the line of control. Think about it. So which agreement had or delineated or separated or brought the line of control? Okay, we have the answers. Okay, so we had very much mixed votings and only one person has given the right answer, which is the Sachetgarh Agreement 1972. See, what is the line of control? Line of control is the border or the line of, you know, that India and Pakistan share. So it is the line of control beyond which the other countries' territory starts. If we talk about the line of actual control, so it is the delineation between India and China on the eastern side of our country, that is on the eastern side of Jammu and Kashmir, while the line of control is on the western side because it delineates or separates India and Pakistan. Okay. All right. So we have question number 21, only two questions to go. The term status quo ante bellum means, so it's a maxim. It means continued the existing state of affairs, state existing before the war, state existing after the war, or none of the above. Status quo ante bellum. Okay, we have the answers. Exactly. So three people have given the right answer. It is the state existing before the war. See, status quo ante bellum. Now, wherever these terms are used, so status quo means state existing. So definitely these could have been the options. But if we talk about ante bellum, so it means before the war. All right. So it cannot be, it is not a continue the existing state of affairs. It is just status quo. So had the question been only about the status quo, option one would have been the right answer, which is like many a times the court also, it gives the judgment to maintain the status quo. So that means to continue the existing state of affairs. But if you talk about status quo ante and the term bellum, so it would mean state existing before the war. Okay, so we have the last question of today's quiz. Who is the present and the first chief of defense staff in India? Now, though it was not there in the article, but we have put it up knowingly. General Bipin Rawat, Rajnath Singh. The time is really less. We already have the answer. Yes. So it is General Bipin Rawat. As we know that recently only for the first time in India, we have this position of chief of defense staff. Basically, the role of the chief of defense staff would be that he would look into all the three staffs that we have, like as in the Army, Air Force, and the Navy, and thus the CDS, this post will be above all these three, and they will be reporting, he will be looking into the affairs and better functioning of all these three forces. So this was created for the first time in Indian history, and thus it was the first one who was General Bipin Rawat, who had actually retired from the Chief of Army Staff post, who has been given the position of Chief of Defence Staff in India. So we finally have the leaderboard now. Let's see. Okay. So the scores are really close. And again, we have Jyoti as the winner. We have Manish, congratulations to all of you as on the second position. We have Boti, Mech Boat Face on the third position. All right. We have Isha on the fourth position, Jasmine on the fifth position, Bill on the sixth position, and ET on the seventh position. So I see that we have some increased participants, which really was great. So congratulations all of you. And from tomorrow at 9 a.m., we will be coming on our CLAT prep channel. It's an apology from our side. There are some technical problems going on. We're really making efforts to, work with them, to get everything sorted. But join us tomorrow. We will be putting forward the code. So this code, we circulate the code a day before. So all right, you already will have the code by this evening or maybe afternoon itself. So you can go to www.menti.com, put up the code that we will have for tomorrow's quiz, and then you can enter the quiz. Also, we will be live on YouTube, so you can join directly from there as well. So thank you so much for joining in. Good luck to all of you. And now when you read the newspaper for the day, keep all these questions in mind and then try to answer. All right, Khushpreet, I guess you have entered now. I'm really sorry. We have already done with the quiz. We have a winner, Jyoti, here. But for tomorrow, please do join us at 9 a.m. We'll be live on YouTube channel as well, Lossico CLAT prep channel. All right. So the link to that particular channel will be available in the description of this video on the YouTube as well. So you join us tomorrow and we will have an even better quiz, I'm sure, over tomorrow. All right. So thank you so much, guys, and good luck. Read the newspaper, stay tuned, and you all will do wonders in the exam. Thank you so much.